Father, we do thank you for this time that you've given to us, Lord. What a joy it is to once again have fellowship with one another, just the fellowship of the brethren. And we thank you for what brings us together, Christ. We thank you for him, who he is, what he has done for us. We thank you for your word that you have preserved for us. And may we go now, may your Holy Spirit deepen our understanding of your word and empower us to obey your word. Maybe we'd be equipped to speak your truth to people and speak it in love. And in so doing, may we bring honor and glory to Christ and him alone. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, well, tonight's session is entitled The Hurt of Healing. And tonight we are going to look at physical healing. Physical healing, is it always God's will? Of course, the faith preachers say, yes, it is. Benny Hinn says this, he promises to heal all, everyone, any whatsoever, everything, all our diseases. That means not even a headache, sinus problem, not even a toothache, nothing. No sickness should come your way. God heals all your diseases. Joseph Prince says this, you are destined to reign in life. You are called by God to be a success. To be a success, to enjoy wealth, to enjoy health, and to enjoy a life of victory. When you reign in life, you reign over sin, over poverty, over every curse, and over every sickness and disease. The faith preachers make no bones about it. You should never be sick. Or if you do get sick, physical healing is guaranteed, provided that you have enough faith, or provided that you sow a seed into some preacher's ministry, give money so you can reap a harvest. And if you're not healed, well, it must be your fault. And of course, that makes sense. If you begin with the premise that it is always God's will for a person to be healed, and a person prays for healing for days, weeks, months, years, some people for decades, but the healing does not come, then the question must be asked, whose fault is it? By definition, it cannot be God's fault, right? Because he's perfect. So the only other one to whom to look is the one who is sick. It's his fault, it's her fault, because they don't have enough faith, they have some unconfessed sin in their lives, or maybe they're not even saved. Unless you think I overstate their case, watch this from Kenneth Copeland.
Well, I don't understand why God healed them and he won't heal me. Could it be by some stretch of the imagination? Oh, probably not, but could it be that it's your fault, not God's? Oh, yeah. Say it. Oh, yeah.
Lest there be any doubt as to their position. If you are sick, it is your fault. The fault must lie squarely at the foot of the sick believer. There's no other conclusion which one can draw. So, are there any Bible verses, or is there any scriptural support to substantiate their doctrine that it is always God's will for us to be physically healed? Are there any proof texts to which they would appeal? There are a few proof texts, and I would like us to look at a few of them. We don't have time to look at all of them, but one of their proof texts, amazingly enough, is Ephesians 5:23. Ephesians 5:23, Benny Hinn says this, and now the Bible says in Ephesians 5:23 that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the body. He is not only the Savior of the soul, he is the Savior of the body. Ladies and gentlemen, you can cry out, you are the Savior of my body, Lord Jesus. You are the Savior of my soul. If Jesus Christ is the Savior of the body, then your body ought to be made whole. Sounds logical, doesn't it? It does. That is, until you actually read Ephesians 5:23. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. One need not be a Greek scholar to know that the body in Ephesians 5:23 is not talking about your flesh and blood body. It's talking about the church. In this kind of Mickey Mouse hermeneutics, this kind of Mickey Mouse Bible interpretation would be laughable, comical, if it weren't that it were leading so very many people astray. Benny Hinn ought to be embarrassed by that. Another one of their verses is maybe the most beloved verse in all of the Old Testament, and we all know it, don't we? Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope. Now the prosperity preachers, they take this verse and they say, see, God has plans to prosper us. There it is, right there, prosperity, health and wealth. And we may not take that verse to those extremes, but we still really like this verse, don't we? You know, we put this verse on our Bible covers, we put it out on our church signs. A lot of people, they make Jeremiah 29:11 their life verse. Be very careful in making Jeremiah 29:11 your life verse. Now the question is what does this verse mean? Not what does it mean to you? If you're ever in a Sunday school class or Bible study class and the leader of the class asks that question, what does this verse mean to you? You know you're in trouble. Dear friends, it doesn't matter what the verse means to you. It doesn't matter what the verse means to me. What matters is what does it mean? Now, every verse in the Bible has but one meaning. Now, many verses may have multiple possible applications, but they've only got one meaning. You know, love your neighbor as yourself. What does that mean? It means to love your neighbor as yourself. How can you apply that? When you can apply it in any number of different ways, but it's only got one meaning. So what is the meaning of Jeremiah 29:11? Well, to know the meaning, we need to look at it in context. This was written to the Jews in Babylonian exile. Raise your hand if you're a Jew and you find yourself in Babylonian exile tonight. No, nobody here in Babylonian exile? Huh. Well, then it wasn't written to us then, was it? Well, why were the Jews in Babylonian exile? The Jews were in Babylonian exile because God had given them instructions to leave their land fallow every seventh year, but for 490 years, the Jews had not done this. And so God sent them into Babylonian exile for 70 years. 490 divided by 7 is 70. God put them in Babylonian exile for 70 years. That's a long time. That's the vast majority of a person's life. And so what God was saying to Israel through the prophet Jeremiah basically was this: look, Israel, I gave you an instruction. You've ignored it for 490 years. My patience has run out. And now you're going to go into Babylonian exile and you're going to be there for 70 years. But I have not forgotten you, Israel. I still have plans for you. Plans not to harm you, but to prosper you, to give you a future and a hope. So this was not written to us. And I'll take it a step further. Even if you had been a Jew in Babylonian exile in this day and age to whom this was written, you still could not have made this your life verse. Why? Because it was not an individual promise. It was a corporate promise to the nation of Israel. Don't you imagine that there were a whole bunch of Jews who died inside the Babylonian exile? Of course. You could have been born 5 years inside the Babylonian exile, lived till you were 60, and you would have spent your entire life in Babylonian exile. So you still could not have made this your life verse. This is why we need hermeneutics, to know how to rightly interpret God's word. Now, is there something that we can learn from this? Yes. Yes, of course. Does God have plans for us? Yes, he does. Does God have plans to prosper us? It depends on what you mean by prosper. How many times have we heard the gospel presented this way? God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. Is that true? Yeah, that is true. God does love us, and he does have wonderful plans for our lives. We were talking a little bit about this, I think, last night. God had a wonderful plan for Stephen's life. The wonderful plan that God had for Stephen's life was to be stoned. God had a wonderful plan for Peter's life. The wonderful plan that God had for Peter's life was to be crucified upside down. God had a wonderful plan for Paul's life. The wonderful plan that God had for Paul's life was to be stoned, imprisoned, shipwrecked, and ultimately beheaded. God does love us, and He does have wonderful plans for our lives. But sometimes what God deems as wonderful may not always seem so wonderful to us. Sometimes God is most glorified in us when we suffer, when we are persecuted, and when we're sick. And yet through the suffering, through the persecution, through the sickness, we remain faithful to Christ and we honor and glorify Him and point others to Him. Sometimes God is most glorified in us in times like that, not when everything is just wonderful. So be very careful making Jeremiah 29:11 your life verse. Another one of their favorite verses is 3 John 2. 3 John 2. This is almost like the gold standard of the prosperity gospel. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in good health, even as thy soul prospers. Watch this from Joyce Meyer.
3 John 2 says, Beloved, I pray that you might prosper in every way, and that your body might keep well, even as I know your soul prospers and keeps well. Now that's a very wonderful scripture. I pray that you would prosper in every way. So he talks about prosperity. He says, I would that you prosper and be in health. And be in health. So we see right there that God wants us to be healthy. Can everybody say, God wants me to be healthy?
Well, you can say it all day long, but that's not what that verse means. John was writing a letter to his friend Gaius, and you would see Gaius's name in the first verse of this short little book, 3 John. And John opens his letter in much the same way that you and I would open a letter or an email that we write to one of our friends today. Basically, John is saying this, Dear Gaius, I hope that this finds you doing well. This is not a blanket promise for guaranteed money and guaranteed healing, not at all. It was a common greeting in letters 2,000 years ago, and it remains a little bit different form, a common greeting in letters that we write today. You can take a lot of verses in Scripture out of their context, and you can make the Bible say whatever you want it to say. Another one of their verses is taken from Matthew chapter 18 about binding and loosing. And they teach that if you are sick, then you just need to bind your sickness. Watch this from Joseph Prince.
Are y'all ready for God's word? Let's go right into God's word. Remember that healing is provided for us. But until you get mad, you know, you say that, no, I'm not going to allow the devil to, all right? Don't forget what Jesus said. Jesus says, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. In the rabbinical teaching, all right, in the rabbinical idea, the rabbis tell us that even the rabbis, they are given keys where they permit some things to happen. And they don't permit some things to happen. Well, Jesus has even greater keys, amen, the key of David. And the thing is that word there doesn't say what God binds, what God disallow, all right? Then you'll be disallowed on earth. No, God says what you prohibit, what you bind, what you disallow, I will disallow in heaven. Whatever you allow, I will allow in heaven. So those that believe in the doctrine, all right, God wants some of us sick and all that. Usually it's not them, it's others. It's not their family, it's always others. Those who believe that God wants some of us sick, they never include themselves.
So according to Joseph Prince, if you're sick, then you just need to bind your sickness. And he gets this from Matthew chapter 18. And if you have your copy of God's Word, feel free to open to Matthew chapter 18. Let's look at this. We'll begin reading in verse 15. Matthew 18:15, Jesus says, If your brother sins, go and show him his fault in private. If he listens to you, you have won your brother. But if he does not listen to you, take one or two more with you, so that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every fact may be confirmed. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. For where two or three have gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. This has absolutely nothing to do with binding sickness and disease. It has everything to do with church discipline. Church discipline? What in the world is that? Do you know this is the very first command that Jesus gave to the church? Right here, first command he gave to the church. Just as much a command as is the Lord's Supper and believer's baptism. Just as much as a command. And so what this is saying, if you know of some brother, at least a professing brother, who is in some habitual unrepentant sin, and you know about it, then you need to go to him and you confront him. And if he listens to you, wonderful, praise the Lord, you have won your brother. Don't talk about it anymore. You know, don't go to Sunday school the next Sunday morning and the Sunday school teacher says, well, does anybody have any prayer requests and praise reports? Me, I have a praise report. I went and I confronted Billy Bob this week and his sin, and Billy Bob repented. Let me tell you what he repented of. No, it's over, done with, forget it. You have won your brother. However, if Billy Bob does not listen to you, then you take one or two more with you and you go back to Billy Bob and you confront him again. And if he listens to you, wonderful, praise the Lord, you have won your brother. Don't talk about it anymore. It's over. But if Billy Bob doesn't listen, then you take it to the church. Oh, you mean you get up on Sunday morning and you tell it to the church? That's right. That's what you do. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, then you treat him as a Gentile and a tax collector. In other words, you treat him as an outsider. Because a genuine Christian can be in serious sin, but when confronted with the truth of God's word, a genuine Christian is going to repent. Now, it may not happen on the spot. That's why there's two more steps, church discipline. But once you follow these steps, a genuine Christian is going to repent. If they don't, they prove themselves to be a false convert. And this is why Jesus said, notice the verb tense here. Whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven, not will be. Whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. In other words, if Billy Bob repents, whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. Billy Bob has been forgiven of his sins, restored into fellowship in the body. However, if he does not repent, then whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound. It's already been bound, or it's already been loosed. In other words, you know that whatever action you take, you can know with 100% certainty that heaven agrees with you. Why? Because you follow the steps of church discipline. This has nothing to do with binding sickness or disease. And as a little bonus, Jesus says, if two of you agree on earth about anything they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. This is not a blank check. You know, you can take that verse out of its context and you can say, oh, well, as long as two or three of us agree on something, then whatever we ask, it'll be granted to us. No, this is not a blank check. This is in the context of church discipline. The two or three refers to the one or two that you take back with you to Billy Bob on step two of church discipline. It has nothing to do with just writing a blank check. And verse 20 is the same way. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. Again, this is talking about church discipline. It doesn't mean that if you're by yourself, Jesus is not with you. Okay, this is talking about church discipline. So, nothing to do with binding or loosing sickness and disease. Now, this is interesting. This is a tweet that I found. Actually, someone sent it to me. And so there's this female Bible teacher on Twitter, and some lady contacted her and said that she was praying for her because this lady apparently had some kind of back problem. So this popular female Bible teacher, she responded. She says, I don't take your prayers lightly, praying blessing back on you. P.S. I often deal with serious pain up and down my spine. Bind it in Jesus' name. So she said, if you have pain in your spine, you know, just bind it. That's all you need to do. Bind it. Bind it in Jesus' name. Now, who do you think wrote this? Joyce Meyer, Christine Kane, Heidi Baker, Beth Moore. Beth Moore. Beth Moore has been hanging around Word Faith teachers, and their theology has rubbed off on her, and now, for all intents and purposes, Beth Moore is pretty much full-blown Word Faith. That is straight-up Word Faith theology right there. Straight up. This from Frederick Casey Price. Price says, how can you glorify God in your body when it doesn't function right? How can you glorify God? How can He get glory when your body doesn't even work? What makes you think the Holy Ghost wants to live inside of a body where He can't see out through the windows, He can't hear with the ears? What makes you think the Holy Spirit wants to live inside of a physical body where the limbs and the organs and the cells do not function right? And what makes you think He wants to live in a temple where He can't see out of the eyes, He can't walk with the feet, He can't move with the hand? The only eyes that He has that are in the earth realm are the eyes that are in the body. If He can't see out of them, then God's gonna be limited. So if you're sick, what makes you think the Holy Spirit of God wants to live inside of you? I can tell you one person He's not living inside of, and that's quote-unquote Apostle Frederick Casey Price. You see the unimaginable cruelty of these people, these wolves. And that is why, as I said Sunday morning, we were talking about false teachers and how Jude describes them, caring only for themselves. They don't give a rip about you. Foundational to the faith preacher's teaching that it is always God's will for us to be healed is their teaching that healing is provided for in the atonement. The atonement, of course, is the word that we give to the work that Jesus did on the cross. Now, we saw Sunday night how the faith preachers don't believe that Jesus paid for our sins on the cross. They believe that He paid for our sins down in hell. But we talked about that Sunday night. But watch this from Andrew Womack.
Jesus placed your and my sickness and diseases, infirmities upon Jesus, and He bore them 2,000 years ago. If He already paid for your healing, how can you doubt that you are healed?
So their reasoning is that when Jesus was on the cross, He paid for our sins, and He also paid for all the consequences of those sins, one of which is sickness and disease. So Jesus bore our sickness, He carried our sorrows, and so we should not have to bear our sickness or our pain or anything like that because Jesus has already done it, so therefore we should be healed. Well, let's look at this in Isaiah 53, 4 and 5. Surely He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem Him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Now the faith preachers look at these two words that I have highlighted here, griefs and sorrows, and they'll say that another way to render these two words is as sickness and pain, respectively. And you know what? They're right. They're right. These two words in Hebrew do have multiple possible renderings. So how do you know which rendering is correct? You know which rendering is correct by the context of the passage. So let's look at the context of the passage. It becomes very clear just by reading the very next verse. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we are healed. So very clearly, the primary context of Isaiah 53 is not talking about physical healing. It's talking about spiritual healing. Not healing from sickness and disease, healing from sin. We see that from these two words, transgressions and iniquities. Yet how many times have we heard Benny Hinn or one of these prosperity preachers say, by His stripes we are healed, so you ought to be physically healed. That's not the primary context. The primary context is healing from sin, not sickness and disease. So, what is the answer to our question? Is physical healing provided for in the atonement? I might surprise you with the answer. Yes. Yes, it is. Dear friends, the reason that I'm crippled, the reason that I walk on crutches, is because of sin. Not my personal sin, but the sin of Adam and Eve. When Adam and Eve sinned, when they ate of that fruit, whatever that fruit was, we don't know that it was an apple. That's just what's in the coloring books. You know, it could have been a pomegranate for all we know. But when they ate of that fruit, sin entered the world, so did sickness and disease and ultimately death, physical and spiritual death. So, yes, the reason that I'm crippled is because of sin. The reason many of you are wearing eyeglasses right now, that's because of sin. Not your personal sin, but the sin of Adam and Eve. Next time you catch a cold, you can blame Adam and Eve for that. It's just one of the consequences of living in a fallen world. So when Jesus came and he died on the cross, he paid for our sins. He also paid for all of the consequences of those sins, one of which is sickness and disease. So yes, physical healing is provided for in the atonement. But here's where the faith preachers get it very, very wrong. Not all of the benefits of the atonement are promised to be fully realized this side of heaven. Okay? Not all the benefits of the atonement we are to realize this side of heaven. Some of the benefits of Jesus' atonement we will not realize until the other side of heaven. And healing from sickness and disease is one of those benefits. To give you another example of this, a glorified body is also provided for in the atonement. Raise your hand if you've got your glorified body. Nobody here has a glorified body? Why not? It's provided for in the atonement. It's not promised to be realized here. Dear friends, when we die and go to heaven, all who are in Christ, when we die and go to heaven, we're not taking our sickness and disease with us. No more cerebral palsy. No more muscular dystrophy. No more arthritis. No more multiple sclerosis. Why? Because our healing has been provided for, bought and paid for with the blood, death, and bodily resurrection of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. But friends, to be real honest with you, when we die and go to heaven, I'm not sure it's even going to cross our minds that we no longer have our sickness and disease. I'm not sure we're even going to give it a second thought. You know why? Because we're going to have better things to think about. Dear friends, we will be in the presence of Christ. Think about that. We will be able to worship Christ fully, unencumbered by any hint of sin. We will be able to worship Him fully and enjoy Him for all of eternity. He is the joy and the glory of heaven. He is who makes heaven, heaven. You know, and so many people, so many of us, we have such a worldly view about heaven. And I hear so many people who claim the name of Christ and they talk about heaven like it's this one big family reunion. We're going to see grandma and grandpa and we're going to walk on streets of gold and, you know, and will we? Yeah. We will be reunited with our loved ones, provided, of course, that they were in Christ when they preceded us in death. But friends, that's not the joy of heaven. When we get to heaven, we will join them in what they are doing right now. They are basking in the glories of Christ. He is the joy and the glory of heaven. And a pretty good indication, I think, of where someone is spiritually in their maturity in Christ is how they view heaven. If you were to take away everything from heaven that we normally think of, take away the pearly gates, take away the streets of gold, take away the mansions, and that's not even the right rendering of that word, but whatever. Take away that. Take away the glorified bodies. Take all of that away. And if you're left with only Christ, Would you be disappointed? And if you would, I would submit to you that your view of heaven is far, far too small. That your view of Christ is far, far too small. He is the joy and the glory of heaven. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. He is who makes heaven, heaven. What of the biblical record? Can we look through the Bible and find examples of people who were faithful servants of God and yet did not walk in perfect divine health? Absolutely. Trophimus was left sick at Miletus. Epaphroditus, sick to the point of death. The Apostle Paul encouraged Timothy to take a little wine for his stomach in his frequent ailments. Now, I find that very interesting. Notice that when the Apostle Paul heard that Timothy had stomach problems and frequent ailments, Paul did not write to Timothy and say, Timothy, go see a faith healer. And be sure you sow a seed into his ministry so you can reap a harvest. Take a little wine for your stomach and your frequent ailments. Now, I find that interesting on yet another level, because the Apostle Paul wrote this to Timothy about the year A.D. 64. A.D. 64. Back up 10 years to the year A.D. 54. What's going on in A.D. 54? The events of Acts chapter 19 are going on. What's happening in Acts chapter 19? Extraordinary miracles of healing. So extraordinary that even handkerchiefs and aprons were being taken from the Apostle Paul, delivered to sick people, and God was healing the sick through the agents of these handkerchiefs and aprons in the year A.D. 54. But fast forward 10 years to the year A.D. 64, no handkerchiefs and aprons going forth from the Apostle Paul. What changed? Something pretty dramatic changed, did it not? Could it be that even in that 10-year span, that the apostolic gifts of tongues, interpretation of tongues, miracles, physical healing, had already begun to fade away, had already begun to pass out of operation? 2 years later, Paul is writing 2 Timothy, and it says that he left Trophimus sick at Miletus. Paul was with him. He was with him. He didn't lay hands on him. He didn't heal him. Didn't give him a prayer cloth. Left him sick. Interesting internal evidence, I think, that even by that time, that the apostolic gifts had already begun to fade away. Job. Job is the 800-pound theological gorilla sitting in the living room of the prosperity preachers, none of whom want to admit is there. Job's a problem for the faith preachers, because it's hard to ignore an entire book out of the Bible. So what do they do with Job? You know, Job suffered horrifically. His possessions destroyed, his family dead, his own health deteriorated. Job suffered more than any man save for the God-man has ever suffered. Job's a problem for the prosperity preachers. So what do they do with Job? You know what they do to Job? They turn the tables on Job. They say that all of these calamities fell upon Job because they were results of his negative confession. Job spoke negative words and brought all of these things upon himself. Do they really teach this? Yes. Joyce Meyer says, "For the thing which I greatly fear comes upon me, and that of which I am afraid befalls me." Fear is a terrible emotion, a self-fulfilling one. Job had fears concerning his children and finally reached a place in his life where he saw his fears coming to pass. The Bible says, "It will be unto us as we believe." Totally takes that verse out of context. That principle works in the negative as well as the positive. It was all Job's fault. You see, Job spoke negative words, and he brought all these calamities upon himself. Job tapped into the dark side of the force. Completely misses the point of the book of Job. I mean, misses it entirely. Dear friends, you know what the point of the book of Job is? The sovereignty of God the sovereignty of God. God can do whatever He wants to do. And you know what? Sometimes that means making us sick. Now, do you believe God can do that, does do that, that He makes people sick? Now, you tell that to a prosperity person, you tell that to someone who's been listening to Joel Osteen, that God makes people sick, they'll probably pass out right on the spot. They won't be able to handle that. You know, they get the vapors. They won't be able to handle that. Well, if God doesn't make people sick, then somebody needs to tell Him that, because He sure seems to think that He does. Exodus chapter 4, verse 11. The Lord said unto Moses, "Who has made man's mouth, or who makes him dumb or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord?" Friends, that's God talking there. I don't know how to get around that. Who has made man's mouth? Who makes him dumb or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? God speaking again, Deuteronomy 32. "See now that I am He, and there is no God besides Me. It is I who put to death and give life. I have wounded, and it is I who heal. And there is no one who can deliver from My hand." Put that verse in your prosperity pipe and smoke it. Sometimes God makes people sick. Now, sometimes we make ourselves sick, don't we? You know, if you lay around all day long on the couch and you do nothing but eat ding-dongs and Twinkies and ho-hos and Little Debbie fudge creams, and, you know, you drink nothing but Dr. Peppers, and you go through 3 or 4 packs of cigarettes a day, don't be surprised if you have some health problems. Sometimes we make ourselves sick. Now, sometimes we get sick simply because we get sick. We live in a fallen world, and people just get sick. Sometimes God makes people sick. Why does He do that? Just to watch us suffer? No. But sometimes He makes us sick to sanctify us and to glorify Himself. To glorify Himself. This is a man that I met some years ago. His name is Rich, and Rich lived in Long Island, New York. Rich is with Christ now. But Rich was born able-bodied, nothing wrong with him. Rich got saved when he was 19 years old, and then just a few years later, in his early 20s, Rich was in a motorcycle accident, and it left him completely paralyzed. No use of his legs at all, very, very limited use of his arms. And Rich lived with his brother and his sister-in-law, his brother's wife, neither of whom are believers, but Rich was. And every Sunday morning, Rich would ask his brother and his sister-in-law to get him up. They get him up out of bed, they dress him, and they put him in his electric wheelchair. And Rich would drive his electric wheelchair 5 miles one way to church every single Sunday. Even when it was raining, they would put a poncho over him, and he would drive his electric wheelchair 5 miles one way to church in the rain. The only thing that kept Rich from going to church was if it was snowing. And his wheelchair just wouldn't go in the snow. But other than that, he was there. The pastor of this church told me, he said, "Justin, Rich is the most faithful church member I've got." He had bumper stickers on the back of his wheelchair with scripture verses on them. He was quite literally a rolling testimony for Christ. Friends, God's glorified in that. How many people over the years saw this man Sunday in, Sunday out, driving his electric wheelchair to church 5 miles one way, sometimes in the rain, smile on his face, scripture verses on the back of his wheelchair. God's glorified in that. And yet we have prosperity preachers like Joel Osteen telling us we should have our best life now. Really? Tell that to Rich. Tell that to our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who are being persecuted for their faith in Christ. Tell that to our brothers and sisters in Christ in Iran, in Syria, North Korea. Tell them that they should have their best life now. Tell them, as Joel Osteen has said in his book, talked about how he got a good parking spot at the mall in the United States of America. He called that the favor of God. Really? Tell that to our brothers and sisters in North Korea who have been arrested and are languishing in hell holes of a prison in North Korea and have been executed simply because they're a Christian. Tell them that the favor of God is getting a good parking spot at a mall in the United States of America. The prosperity preachers have no understanding of the gospel. None. But Rich does, especially now. Many of our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world, they do. Prosperity preachers and those who follow them, not a clue. Not a clue as to what the gospel is. Elisha had a double portion anointing of the great prophet Elijah, yet we read in 2 Kings 13 that Elisha was fallen sick of his sickness whereof he died. Dear friend, it is a matter of biblical record that not everyone who loved the Lord and served him faithfully walked in perfect divine health. It's not a matter of opinion. It's not up for debate. It's simply a matter of biblical record. Does God still heal people today? Yes, he does. But only when it is his sovereign will to do so. Does God always heal people today? No, he does not. He wasn't doing it in the days of the Bible, and he's not doing it today either. According to the prosperity preachers, if you want to be healed, one of the requirements you must meet, show me the money. You better sow that seed. Sow a seed so you can reap a harvest. You want to know where some of your money is going? A lot of your money is going? This picture is over 10 years old now, but that's me in my scooter. I managed to get into Kenneth Copeland's hangar. Those are just two of his planes. Just two of them. And by the way, he has a newer model now. This one on the right, that's been replaced by a newer, fancier jet. I actually managed to get on that jet. Long story, I won't. But I managed to get on there. I sat in Kenneth Copeland's private jet. Left a gospel track on the seat. And that's another one, the 308. That's a toy. That's just one of his toys. Kenneth Copeland is now, by his own admission, he's almost, if not already, a billionaire with a B. Yeah, sow that seed. Yeah, send these multimillionaire preachers your money. Watch this from Joyce Meyer.
Do I believe that God wants to bless us? Yes.
But when you go to the conferences, you ask people to give money. So
sure.
You say, do it cheerfully.
Yeah.
Because
the Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. See, giving is a major part of the whole Christian doctrine.
But do you believe that if someone gives money to the ministries,
right,
that more will come back to them?
Yes. Absolutely.
I think that's what they mean by prosperity gospel.
Yes.
No, but do you worry at all that sometimes your message will be heard by someone in the most dire circumstances? This is sort of roulette wheel, a sort of gamble with God. Okay, well, I can't pay the rent, but I'll give it to Joyce and we'll see what happens. Do you worry at all that happens?
I don't worry about that.
Well, no, she totally doesn't worry about that. I'm sure she doesn't. But you know what? She should. Because right now, there are people all over the world and they are watching Christian television and they're at home and they're sick, or they have a sick spouse, or they have a sick child. And they're being told, if you need a miracle, you need to sow a seed. And so in desperation, they pull out their checkbook, they pull out their credit card, and they send in money that most of these people can't afford to give, and they send it in to these multimillionaire preachers flying in private jets and driving Bentleys. I'm sure she doesn't worry about it, but she ought to. One day, these false teachers will have to stand before a holy God, and they will have to give an account for what they are doing to the sick, to the hurting, to the desperate. and they will have to give an account for what they are doing to the gospel. Rod Parsley wants you to sow a seed into his ministry. Very specific seed, $54.17. Why $54.17? Well, based off of Isaiah 54, verse 17, of course. You didn't know that? Silly goose. Watch this from Rod Parsley.
There's a battle raging, and it's raging right now. A fierce, all-out attack against you, against everything of great value in your life. But my dear, dear friend, your commander-in-chief has full supremacy, absolute authority, and he's decreed and declared that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. On this broadcast, you're about to discover how to receive for yourself his miraculous anointing of provision and protection. Stay right where you are. I'm Rod Parsley. And I'm going to take you at your word. I'm going to stand up in faith, and I'm going to sow an Isaiah 54:17 seed of $54.17. Let's go to the phone. Do it right now. Go to the phone. Right now. This is a moment of faith that may never, ever, ever be repeated again. But God is saying, if you're hearing this word, take hold of it. Seize this moment. Claim this word right now as your own word and say, God, that's me. That's my family. That's my business. That's my ministry. That's my church. God, those are my children. That's my marriage. So I feel the adversary releasing his stranglehold. Are you going to your phone? $54.17. Are you going to your phone right now?
Are you going to your phone? Are you going to your phone right now? You know why they want you to hurry up and go to your phone? Because they know that if you actually stop and think a little bit, you might not go to your phone. And you might not sow your $54.17 seed into his ministry. But let's be fair to Rod Parsley, shall we? Let's look at Isaiah 54, verse 17. No weapon that is formed against you will prosper. Wow. Well, it does say that, doesn't it? In every tongue that accuses you in judgment, you will condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication is from me, declares the Lord. Huh. Wow, well, it does say that. Well, a couple of points to be made here. Number one, dear friends, there is nothing inherently, there's nothing special about 54:17. Okay, the chapter divisions and the verse numbers were not in the original manuscripts. 54:17, those chapter divisions and verse numbers were added way, 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 way later. And just to help us look things up a little bit more easily in the Bible. So there's nothing special about 54:17. But it does say that no weapon that is formed against you will prosper. So is this for us? Well, again, this was written to Israel as well. But it does say this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. So aren't we servants of the Lord? Of course we are. So is this our heritage? Yes, it is. But it's kind of like healing in the atonement. Is it promised to be realized here and now? No, it's not. It is true that in the grand scheme of things, when God brings all things to their appointed end, in the eschaton, it is true that no weapon that is formed against God or his people will prosper. That's true. God wins. But it seems to me that the weapon that was formed in the blacksmith's shop, the sword that lopped off the head of the Apostle Paul, that weapon seemed to prosper. The sword that lopped off the head of John the Baptist, that weapon seemed to prosper. The nails that affixed Peter to a cross upside down, those weapons seemed to prosper. So, again, taken out of context. But you know what's really interesting about this? Is verse 17 is the last verse of Isaiah 54. Now, why didn't Rod Parsley just drop down one more verse to say Isaiah 55 verse 1. I mean, just one more little verse, and he could have had 84 more cents per sower if he had just dropped down one more verse. Isaiah 55 verse 1. You know why he didn't? I'll show you why he didn't. Here it is. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. You who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. That's why he didn't want you to look at the very next verse, because it totally obliterates everything he was just saying. You think Rod Parsley doesn't know that that verse is the next verse? Oh, yeah, he knows it. He just doesn't want you to know it. One day, these false teachers will have to stand before a holy God, and they will have to give an account for what they are doing to God's people. Watch this from Mike Murdoch. Mike Murdoch is one of the more loathsome individuals in this movement. Watch this from Mike Murdoch as he actually specifically targets widows.
There is a widow who is watching Daystar, watching us right now. And you're sitting there, and your thoughts are, wow, I wish I was young again, and I wish I had a business, but I'm on a fixed income, and I don't know where I would get the $58. That's what makes it faith. That's what makes it faith.
Actually targeting widows on fixed incomes. You know where these people get a lot of their money from? Widows. Little old ladies who can't get out of their home anymore, or they're in their retirement home, and tragically their only church, quote unquote, is this garbage they see on Christian television. One day, these false teachers will have to stand before a holy God. You know, oftentimes we think of the deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell being reserved for people like Adolf Hitler and Stalin and Mussolini and Osama bin Laden. You know, those are the really bad guys, right? They're in the deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell. Oh, they're in hell. Ain't no doubt about it. They're in hell. But I would submit to you that the deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell is not going to be populated, or is not populated, with people like Adolf Hitler and Osama bin Laden. The deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell will be reserved for those people who had the most exposure to the truth, and yet they rejected it. And these people have been exposed to a lot of truth. They've got the same Bible we've got. And it's not that they don't know what's in it. They do know what's in it. But they choose to twist it, to take it out of its context, and to exploit people, and to distort the gospel, and bring reproach on the name of Christ. The deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell is going to be reserved for people like that. Another requirement to receive your healing, according to the faith preachers, your heart must be right with God. You must have a right heart, and you must persevere in your search for a miracle. This is what Benny Hinn said at the first Benny Hinn Crusade that I went to. This was back in 2002. Benny Hinn said this. He said, "You cannot receive healing unless your heart is right with God. Healing is easily attained when your walk with God is right." So stop for a minute and put yourself in the shoes of someone who is there and they are sick. They're in a wheelchair. They have cancer. They have a sick child. And then they hear something like that. And when the show is over, they leave in the same wheelchair with the same cancer, with the same sick child. Now not only do they have their illness with which to deal, now they also have to worry about their own spiritual deficiencies, that there's something wrong with their walk with the Lord simply because they're sick. Simply because they're sick. Now I do want to be careful, and I want to say if someone is at a Benny Hinn crusade, that is an indication that something's not right. You're either dealing with a very young, immature Christian who just doesn't know any better yet, or someone who claims to be a Christian and isn't really. But the point of the matter is this, is being sick is not a reason in and of itself to doubt your walk with Christ. Not at all. Not at all. Benny Hinn said you must have a right heart and you must persevere. You must persevere in your search for healing. At the same crusade that I went to, this was the second Benny Hinn crusade I went to was in Dallas, Texas, at the American Airlines Center. And I was getting out of my van. At the time, I had a van with a hydraulic lift on it, and I was on my scooter and all that. And I was getting out, and I was watching. There was another van kind of like right next to me. And there was a woman who got out, and she was getting who I would soon find out to be her son on a wheelchair on the lift. And I was just kind of watching them a little bit. And I was I went over to them, and I started talking with them, because that's, you know, I want to talk to people when I go to these things. And her son was in this wheelchair, and she told me that at the time he was 32 years old, and he was in this wheelchair, and he was he had absolutely no control over his body whatsoever. His arms and legs had to be strapped down because of extreme spasticity. His head even had to be strapped back because he couldn't hold his own head up. He was wearing a bib because he was constantly just drooling on himself. And I was just talking with this lady, and I looked at their license tag, and it said New Hampshire. We were in Dallas, Texas. And I said, "Ma'am, are you from New Hampshire?" And I knew it had to be her own van because of the lift and all that. And I said, "Ma'am, are y'all from New Hampshire?" She said, "Oh, yes. We follow Benny Hinn all over the country." Can you imagine what this poor woman must go through, lugging her incapacitated son, who was bigger than she was, all over the country, thinking, this will be the time. And it never is. It's no skin off Benny Hinn's back. No, he just takes their love offering, takes their money, and he goes to his $10 million parsonage overlooking the ocean in California. And he leaves these people behind to pick up the pieces. Watch this from John Hagee.
That's what that means. Let me tell you, sickness comes from the devil. And when you walk into a hospital room and your friend is there, a member of your family is there, you have the power to say, "In the name of Jesus, I rebuke that disease." And the God of heaven will heal that disease when you are right with God in heaven.
So John Hagee says that if you have a friend or family member who's in the hospital, you have the authority to go into that hospital room, and as long as you're right with God, that sickness must leave. You command it to leave, and the sickness must leave. This aired in March of 2010. Do you know where John Hagee was about a year and a half before this, in October of 2008? You know where John Hagee was? John Hagee was lying flat on his back on an operating table with his chest cracked open, having quadruple bypass surgery. Why didn't he just command his arteries to clear up? Would have saved himself an awful lot of time and heartache, pardon the pun. You know, I take no joy that John Hagee had to have quadruple bypass surgery. I take no joy in that, but I do find it interesting that what the faith preachers preach doesn't seem to work for them. And if what the faith preachers preach doesn't work for them, that ought to be a clue to them. There just might be something wrong with what they're preaching. Why are they sick? Essex W. Kenyon, the grandfather of this movement, died from a tumor. Kenneth Hagin, the father of the modern Word of Faith movement, died from heart disease. Oral Roberts died from heart disease. Rod Parsley had cancer a few years ago. Jan Crouch, the founder and president of TBN, died of a stroke about 2 years ago. And Nora Lamb, the faith healer that I went to see when I was a teenager, had a massive stroke in 2003, died early the next year. Friends, the faith healers get sick just like us common folk do. And if what the faith preachers preach doesn't work for them, that ought to be a clue to them. There might be something wrong with what they're preaching. This is an interesting photograph I came across. Jesse Duplantis, Benny Hinn, and John Hagee. Now, look at the man in the middle, Benny Hinn. What's he got on his face? Oh, eyeglasses. Mr. Miracle himself has to wear eyeglasses. Friends, never trust a faith healer who's wearing eyeglasses. Watch this from George Pearson's and Gloria Copeland.
We've been talking about living in God's circle of protection. That protection belongs to us.
Yes, it does.
We have a covenant of protection.
We have a circle of
protection. Yep, we do. And we have scriptures after scripture after scripture that guarantee us that no matter where we are and no matter where we go, we are redeemed from the curse of the law. We are redeemed from the curse of destruction.
Well, the first thing that I would point out is he too is wearing eyeglasses, but he says we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, and of course that is true, but because we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, therefore we should not be sick, because being sick is a part of the curse, right? Living in a fallen world. Well, a couple of things I would point out about this. So we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, which means therefore we should not be sick. What is one specific physical condition that the Bible describes as affecting but one of the two genders as a that is a direct result of the fall? What is it? Pain in childbirth, right? Now, obviously, I wouldn't know this from personal experience, but what you reckon that all the women in the Word Faith movement, when they have children, what you reckon it hurts? I bet it does. Oh, but we've been redeemed from the curse of the law. Really? Well, did it hurt when you had your baby? See, their own theology doesn't make any sense. And also, next time someone tells you, well, you should be healed because we've been redeemed from all of the effects of the curse and living in a fallen world, okay, ask them this question. Really, have you stopped aging? Because the reason we age is the same reason we get sick. The reason we cannot physically do at age 80 what we could do when we were 20 is because we live in a fallen world, and slowly but surely, day by day, living in this fallen world is taking its toll on our bodies. So next time someone says, oh, we've been redeemed from all the effects of the curse, we should not be sick. Okay, have you stopped aging? Take out a picture of yourself from 15 years ago. Let's take a look. And you know what? Until these people stop aging, they've got nothing to say to us. Nothing. Are you not healed according to the prosperity preachers? Well, it's probably because you just don't have enough faith. You don't have enough faith. Watch this from Benny Hinn.
My friend, hear this well. The reason people lose their healing is because they begin questioning if God really did it. We receive it by faith. We keep it by faith. Say by faith.
Hand and touched his garment. Now, before she touched, verse 1 to 8 says, For she said. Say that with me. In other words, she knew. She knew she's going to get a miracle. First key, she heard. Second key, she came. Third key, she knew. When you know, you're on the way. But if you sit there and say, I'm not sure, you just lost it.
What does laying your hands on a human have to do with healing? Well, really nothing. We touch people all the time, they're still sick. What he's looking for is permission. The power to heal is always present, but having permission to heal is held up by humanity and their lack of faith. Hallelujah.
Having permission to heal is held up by humanity and their lack of faith. Watch this from Jan Crouch.
I'm not afraid to ask him anything. The other day, you see that bite right there? There was a mosquito hanging on there. And I thought it was a helicopter. You know, it could have been. It scared me then. I just said, Jesus, heal it. And you know what? He did.
So Jan Crouch says that she had a mosquito bite, and she points to it, And she said, Jesus, heal it. And you know what? He did. Well, you know what? I don't know if you can see it from that distance, but when you look at this video up close, when she points to her arm, you can actually see a little red, you know, bump on her arm where the mosquito was. Well, if Jesus healed her of her mosquito bite, what in the blue world is she pointing at? It doesn't make any sense, but do you see how trivial that is? That Jesus healed her of her mosquito bite. Bless her bones. Jesus healed her of her mosquito bite. You know what I wish I could do now? Jan Crouch is dead now. He didn't heal her of that stroke. But you know what I wish I could do? Wish I could have done? I wish I could have taken Jan Crouch, shown her this video of herself, and all of her faith prosperity friends, Joel Osteen, the whole lot of them. And I'd like to introduce them to this young man, Matt Arnold. Matt Arnold is this young man in the wheelchair. Matt has the same condition that I do. He has cerebral palsy, but it's far, far, far worse. Far worse than what I got. Matt cannot do anything for himself physically. He can't give himself a drink of water. He can't feed himself. Matt certainly can't walk. He can't do anything. He can't roll over. If you were to lay Matt down on the floor, that's where he would stay. Matt can't even speak. He's completely nonverbal. His CP is that severe. But his mind, his intellect, is just as sharp as any of ours. He's just trapped in a body that he can't control. Just as sharp, just as smart as any of us. So. But you know what happened to Matt when he was 16 years old? God saved him. And Matt now is in his mid-20s. And Matt loves the Lord. He loves theology. He loves doctrine. He has actually taken Bible college classes online with the help of his dad. Matt speaks through some kind of a computer device. I don't even know how it works, but he can somehow communicate at some level through this computerized device. Matt loves the Lord. Loves the Lord. And yet Jan Crouch said that Jesus healed her of her mosquito bite? Really? But you know what? Matt just doesn't have enough faith. That's what it is. He doesn't have enough faith to be healed, you see. I have precious little patience with someone who would go up to a suffering and sick believer and say, the reason you're sick is because you don't have enough faith. I have very, very little patience with people like that. Dear one, if you are here tonight and you know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, don't let anybody tell you that you don't have enough faith to be healed. Because if you have been granted the faith to be saved, you have certainly got enough faith to be healed. Because being saved is by far the greatest miracle. The greatest miracle is not when the blind see. It's not when the lame walk. The greatest miracle is when the dead are raised. Not physically dead, spiritually dead. Dead in trespasses and sins, raised to newness of life in Christ. When God makes us alive. That is the greatest miracle of all. If you have been granted the faith to be saved, don't let anybody ever tell you that you don't have enough faith to be healed. Because being saved is by far the greatest miracle. The new birth, that is the greatest miracle. That is the greatest miracle. And Matt knows that if he has to live the rest of his life on earth with his cerebral palsy, as hard as, and I can't imagine what it's like for Matt. I can't. He knows that this life is but a vapor. And one day he will have all of eternity to live without it. And he will have all of eternity to enjoy Christ. That's the power of the gospel. And as I close tonight, I want to close with the gospel. I never want to take it for granted that everyone knows Jesus. And we all love to hear the gospel again, don't we? It never gets old. Has there been a time in your life when you have been convicted by the Holy Spirit of God that you are a sinner? That you have broken God's laws? All of us are liars. We are thieves. We are blasphemers. We are adulterers at heart, at least. All of us have broken God's laws thousands and thousands of times throughout the courses of our lives, in word and deed, in thought. And just like when we break laws on earth, there is a penalty to be paid. How much more so when we break the laws of God? But because we have sinned against God, who is eternal, the punishment of that sin is also eternal. And if we die in our sins, we will very rightly and very justly go to a very real place that the Bible calls hell. And the worm will not die. The fire will not be quenched. The wrath of God will be poured out day and night, forever and ever and ever, and it will never end. And the most terrifying thing about hell is God, because He is there. He is there in His mode of judgment. He is there in His mode of wrath. And His wrath will be poured out on the ungodly. And the fires of hell do not bring repentance. And people in hell will hate God and curse God just as much, more so, than they did on earth. And so God's wrath continues to be poured out. That's what you deserve. That's what I deserve. That's the bad news. But there is good news. And the good news of the gospel is this, is that God loves you. God loves you, and He has made a way of escape. He has made a way for you to escape His wrath. He has made a way for you to be saved from Himself. And God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to this earth. And Jesus lived a perfect life. He never broke any of the laws of God. He was the perfect, spotless Lamb, the Lamb without blemish. And Jesus willingly laid down His life on the cross. His life was not taken. He gave it. And on the cross, He bore the wrath of God that your sins have earned, that my sins have earned. He bore God's wrath, and He satisfied God's wrath on our behalf. Our sins were counted towards Him, and He satisfied God's wrath. And so we must have His righteousness, of which we have none on our own. We must have the righteousness of another. We must have the righteousness of Christ. How do we get the righteousness of Christ? When we turn from sins, repent of sins, and place our trust in what He did on the cross. His work on the cross. Not our own works. Our works are as filthy rags before a holy God. They do us no good. Abandon your works. Leave them. Leave them behind. They will profit you nothing. You have no righteousness on your own. I have none on my own. We need the righteousness of Christ. And when we repent of sin and place our trust in Him, His righteousness is imputed to us. It is credited to our account. How do you know if you have the righteousness of Christ? How do you know that you've been born again? Well, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5, he says, examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Has there been a change in your life? You can't go from being dead in sin to alive in Christ and there be no change. Has there been a change in your life? Do you love the things that God loves? Do you hate the things that God hates? Do you grieve over your sin? Not do you not want the consequences over your sin, do you grieve over your sin? When you sin, does it grieve you? Because you understand that your sin grieves God. And it is good and it is right to want a Savior from hell. But just as much as we should want a Savior from hell, we should want a Savior from our sin. And a lot of people, they just want a savior from hell. They want to get out a free card, get out of hell free card. But they don't really want a savior from their sin. Secretly, they love their sin. And if they could get away with it, they would indulge in it. If that's you, you do not know Christ. Just as much as we should want a savior from hell, we should want a savior from our sin. Does your sin grieve you because you understand that it grieves God? And do you desire to turn from sin? Do you want Christ more than you want your sin? Do you have a love for Christ? Do you have a love for His Word? Are you growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ? Salvation is not perfection. I'm not talking about sinless perfection. Christians do sin. We stumble into sin, but we don't swim in sin. We don't enjoy sin. We don't relish sin. When we do sin, it grieves us. Are you growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ? Salvation is not perfection, but it is direction. Which direction is your life going? Is there an upward trajectory of holiness? Is there a downward trajectory of the grip that sin has on you? Do you have a love for the brethren? These are all fruits in keeping with repentance. And if you're not certain of where you are in your relationship with Christ, I would implore you to get real honest before God. Cry out to Him. Confess your sin to Him. And throw your mercy upon Him. Throw yourself upon His mercy. Trust Him as your Savior. Jesus says, "The one who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out." Dear friend, if you come to Christ seeking a Savior from your sin, He will save you. He will save you. You will pass from death to life. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. And as we get ready to, I'm going to pray, and then we'll go into time of Q&A. But if you're here tonight and maybe you're not certain of where you are with the Lord, please come to me, come to Pastor Jeremy, you know, come to Julio, come to Cade. I mean, there are men here who would love to talk with you. And don't leave here if you have questions. Okay, we'll close in a word of prayer, and then we'll have some Q&A. Let's go to God. Father, we thank You for this day that You have given to us. We thank You for Your mercies. We thank You for Your gospel. We thank You that You have indeed made a way for us to escape the just penalty that we deserve. We thank You that You have sent Your Son, Jesus, to this earth, and we thank You that He satisfied Your wrath on our behalf. Father, I pray that as the gospel has been preached tonight, I pray that Your Holy Spirit would convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment, convict of the truth of the gospel. And if there is anyone here tonight who does not know Christ, Lord, call them to Yourself. May they hear the voice of the shepherd. May they go to Him for Your glory, to the praise of the glory of Your grace. And Father, I pray for this church. I pray for the saints here. I pray that You would, that this would be a light, a beacon of truth here in Laredo. And I pray that this church would grow, not only in numbers, but grow in depth and grow in the grace and knowledge of Christ. That You would be honored and glorified through this body. It's in His name we pray. Amen.